What's going on, guys? The Comics Kid 2099 here to examine X-Men issue 116. This is by Chris Claremont and John Byrne, with Terry Austin, Tom Orzechowski, Glynis Wien, Roger Stern, and Jim Shooter. This issue, the X-Men and Kazar are in the Savage Land. A godlike being called Garrok the Petrified Man has teamed up with Zaladane, who is another native of the Savage Land, and they have built this gigantic city that is putting the entire Savage Land at risk. And at the end of the previous issue, I was kind of under the impression that this was also going to put the entire planet at risk. It's snowing in the Savage Land, and that's messing up with the ecology, and therefore that is going to have an impact on the rest of the planet. But it never actually says that in this issue. They just keep talking about how the Savage Land is at risk, but they don't really mention how the entire world is at risk as well. So I may have misread that in the previous issue. But the X-Men, they see the giant city, and then they're going to go in there and do something. I don't know how they plan to stop Garrok from doing what he's doing. I guess the city itself is what is putting the weather patterns out of whack. Are they planning on destroying an entire city? How are they going to do that? We don't really know what the X-Men's plan is, but it's out of their hands because some of Garrok's men attack them, and they are able to capture Kazar, Cyclops, Banshee, and Colossus. And once again, we see that when the X-Men are all just kind of off doing their own thing, they're not very effective against their enemies. When they had teamwork, they were able to defeat Magneto. But when they're all just kind of, I'm going to go do this thing, while Wolverine goes and does that thing, and they're not really waiting for orders, and Cyclops is not giving orders. It's like a page before Cyclops decides to start trying to take control of the situation. But so many of these guys all get captured, and I feel like that wouldn't have happened if Cyclops had acted a little more quickly, and if the X-Men had allowed him to give some orders. But then Wolverine, of all people, kind of takes charge, and he tells Kazar, Sabretooth Tiger, Zabu to go back to the Fall People and tell them to bring their army to go and help the X-Men. And then Wolverine, Nightcrawler, and Storm, they sneak into the city. At one point, Wolverine kills a guard, and then Storm compares him to a wildcat with no mercy. And then at one point, a dinosaur tries to bite Wolverine's hand off, and then he's able to snicket, snicket, snarl, and then kill the dinosaur. It's a pretty brutal kill without actually showing anything. Props to John Byrne for managing to make that seem very gruesome without even a single drop of blood on the page. And this might be the first time that Wolverine's healing factor is mentioned. I haven't been keeping up with when they mention like his powers. We know that when Stephen Lang had captured the group, that they said Wolverine might not be a mutant. These readings are not exactly like all the others. So we know there's something wrong with him, but here, Storm says, look, you're wounded, and he says, it's not too bad, I heal really fast, and he says, there's not a beast on this planet that can break my bones. It hasn't been officially revealed that he has adamantium coating his entire skeleton at this point, but that seems to be a hint that even this far back, that Claremont and Byrne were kind of thinking about that. But I may have missed some mention of him having a healing factor in an earlier issue. I can't remember, but right now I'm thinking this might be one of the first mentions of him having a healing factor. But Colossus, Cyclops, and Banshee and Kazar are about to be sacrificed so that Garrok can make an example out of them. He wants this to be an era of peace, and these guys, according to him, are breaking his laws, and he needs to make an example out of them so that he can actually see their be peace in his land. And I was a little confused in the previous issue. Were we going to have Garrok basically be an okay guy being manipulated by Zaladane, who is power hungry, and she is actually going to try and rule the Savage Land, and Garrok will be more of a puppet leader controlled by her? Or is he also kind of up to no good, and Zaladane is just taking advantage of that, and she's also up to no good? And reading this issue, I still don't know the answer to that. He's willing to sacrifice these guys. According to him, they were breaking his laws, except that at this point, Garrok hasn't set any laws up. The X-Men hadn't even met Garrok at this point when his people came and kidnapped them. I have no idea what laws Garrok thinks that they broke, but they have only heard about Garrok through Kazar. And so it'd be one thing if Kazar, according to Garrok, had broken one of his laws, and then he says, well, these guys were working with Kazar, and they were going to try and destroy my kingdom, and then set us back 10,000 years, and it's just going to be anarchy all over the land. It'd be fine if we had that, or if Zaldane was telling him that's what's going on, and then he believes her. It's really unclear how evil is Garrok, and I still don't know by the end of this issue. And maybe it would have helped if I had read some of the Astonishing Tales issues and some of Kazar's own series. I haven't read any of that, but just looking at these issues, it's a little difficult to tell just how evil Garrok is. But anyway, the X-Men are able to free Kazar and the other X-Men who have been captured. A big fight erupts. Garrok runs away because he is basically as strong as a normal human being. He was severely weakened building this giant city. So he wants to go somewhere so he can absorb energy from the geothermal vent that the city is built on. Cyclops tries to stop him. And then Cyclops and Garrok fall in a big hole. Nightcrawler is able to save Cyclops, and Storm goes after Garrok, but she's not able to save him. She accidentally hesitates at the last minute, and then she comes up, and then Wolverine tells Banshee, hey, leave her alone. She's going to need some time to process this. Someone died because she wasn't fast enough to save him. And then Dr. Lykos tells the X-Men, hey, I'm going to stay right here. I'm not going back to the real world. Everyone there thinks that I'm dead. Let's keep it that way. And I'll be honest, even though Dr. Lykos / Sauron was introduced as a villain in the 60s, I kind of like him better as more of a heroic figure with the possibility of going rogue in the Savage Land. In the 90s, very early 90s, it was in Rob Liefeld's X-Force run, Sauron joined Toad's Brotherhood of Mutants. And I don't really like that. I prefer Sauron staying in the Savage Land. Yes, that means that you would see him much less often, but when you go to the Savage Land in any series, whether it's Avengers or X-Men or whenever Spider-Man goes to the Savage Land, I know Daredevil went once in the 60s, whenever you go to the Savage Land in any series, you can show Kazar, and he's like, I don't know, an ambassador from America, and he's helping build schools or something like that. I'd love to see you do stuff like that with Sauron / Dr. Lykos. And then maybe eventually he could kind of get the Sauron persona a little bit under control, kind of like Dr. Banner and Hulk. That'd be kind of cool to see. But alas, eventually Sauron will go back to the world of man in the 90s. I know in the early 2000s there was a Weapon X series with a group of C and D list characters that the Weapon X program had working for them, and Sauron was one of them, played entirely differently than he is in these appearances. But anyway, that is neither here nor there for this issue. The X-Men go into a long tunnel, and they come out somewhere in the ocean, I'm assuming pretty close to Antarctica. So this once again throws into question, is the Savage Land underground or not? I mentioned this when I talked about issue 115, how way back in the 60s the Savage Land was deep underground, and it was not above ground where the rest of Antarctica is, but then I was a little bit unsure if that's still the case as of now. But they go into an underground tunnel, it seems like, and come out somewhere in the ocean. So maybe it is, maybe it's not. I'm still not really sure. I don't know scientifically how that would work if the Savage Land is underground and they go into a tunnel and come out above that in the ocean. How would they go through the tunnel into the ocean? I don't really know how that would work. Or if the Savage Land is at ground level, and then they go a little bit under and then a little bit up and come out in the tunnel. I'm still not really sure. But anyway, they come out in the middle of a storm, and then it says next issue we're going to have Cywar. I normally don't try to spoil what's going on in the next issues, but I believe the next issue is the introduction of the Shadow King. So that will be cool. We will get to see a little bit of what Professor Xavier and presumably Jean Grey are doing while they believe the X-Men are dead. So not a whole lot going on in this issue. I think I could have really liked Garrok and Zaldane, but I almost think we needed another issue to kind of see what their plans were, what they were up to. Is Garrok as bad as Kazar says? I think we could have had another issue. Admittedly, I have complained before about storylines that go on way too long, that could have been extremely condensed, and this one is really only two issues. You had the X-Men hanging out in the Savage Land for a little while, and then you had Kazar met them, and and Sauron met them, and then you have this issue. So they've been in the Savage Land 3 issues, but this storyline has really only been 2 issues long. But I think we could have had another issue to kind of delve more into these antagonists. I think that would have been cool. I have no idea if we see Garrok again. We will see Zaladan again. I have no idea how she survived an entire city collapsing, but she does show up again the late 80s, around the time, I know Art Adams drew her at one point. If you are familiar with the Monkey Man and O'Brien comics from Dark Horse Comics, Art Adams drew those, and incidentally, the main character in that, her sister is the bad guy, and the sister in the Monkey Man and O'Brien comics, it's been a few years since I've read those, but I seem to recall that the sister was the bad guy in the Monkey Man and O'Brien comics, and she looks kind of like Art Adams' rendition of Zaladan. So thought that was kind of interesting. If you watch my video on issue 115, you know that eventually it's retconned that Polaris and Zaladan are sisters. Maybe. We don't know. But anyway, thought that was interesting. So if you're interested in the Art Adams Monkey Man and O'Brien comics from Dark Horse from the early 90s, that is a bizarre possible connection to the X-Men books. But anyway, that's about all that I have to say for issue 116. I hope that you guys like this video. And in the meantime, I'll see you guys in the future. Have a good one.